Timothy. Pastor Timothy. Get up here. So we brought the ice cream truck out here today for y'all. Not just for no reason, but a year ago on September 18th, which was a Sunday, which is tomorrow, but a year ago on this Sunday, we ordained Pastor Timothy at this church. So we just wanted to honor him with one of his favorite things in the world, which is ice cream. So one of the things that him and I have in common, I like chocolate, he likes vanilla. So that's why he plays bass and I play the guitar. So. But it's been a blessing to have you, brother. And thank you for your service and your heart to serve this church and to serve our congregation. So thank you, brother.
I'm blessed. Let me just... quickly, I'm totally blessed. If you guys knew my life 5 years ago, it was completely different. The Lord has done wonders, and I'm blessed to be here. You guys are awesome. I love you.
Oh, man. I'm crying and I didn't hear a word he said because of my ears are still ringing. Can you turn this up a little bit? Getting too old to play that loud. Blinded by the light. Anyone? You know Bruce Springsteen wrote it, right? I never heard his version, though. I didn't even know he wrote it until I was looking it up this week. Okay, so go. Oh, man, that was terrible. Man, you guys are all over the place. Forget it. I'm not even going to give you a second chance. You know I post these things to you guys on Facebook so you have a chance to practice before you get here. I guess I'll have to start picking some easier songs. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to the book of Acts, chapter 9. Jesus said in the book of John, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall never walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Acts chapter 9, verse 1 through 9. If you're there, say, I got it. Yeah. And you'll wait till she finishes with her phone call. Tell him I said hello. Put him on speaker and let him listen to the whole message. She needs to be here? Is she on the phone right now? Bring it here. Let me talk to her. Hi, how you doing? We're missing you at church this morning. God bless you. Yeah, we're at church. You still got time to make it. Yeah. We'll wait for you. We got ice cream. Acts chapter 9, verse 1 through 9. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him, the high priest, to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. I don't know if you remember this, but in the 70s, they referred to Christians as the way. And there used to be these bumper stickers all over everybody's car with an arrow. Does anybody remember that, or am I older than all of you? You're old if you remember that. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? Then the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goats. So he, Paul, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus. And there he was 3 days without sight. He neither ate nor drank. This is a pretty popular story. And the road to Damascus conversion has been a popular theme for people that have had an immediate transition or an immediate relationship with God. And transformation. I didn't have that. And this road to Damascus sort of transition, enlightening, kept me from being fully devoted and fully obedient to the Lord for a long time because I didn't have it. And I thought, well, if I don't have this road to Damascus conversion and this encounter with the Lord, then I must not be believing in my heart. I must not have enough faith. Or maybe God isn't really ready to appear to me, or maybe God's not ready to bring me into the kingdom. So I would always think like, well, since I haven't had this overnight conversion, then I would always go back to my old life, right? And then my old life would just get hectic and horrible and dark again, and then I would try to go back, and I would try to look for this overnight conversion. And it took me many, many, many years to figure out that overnight road to Damascus conversion isn't for everyone. Paul was lucky, right? Or Paul was blessed, and God chose him for that. But if that's not you, don't give up, because sometimes it takes a while. I always say, Jesus cleans his fish after he catches them, right? It takes a while. It took a while for him to get me to a place where I could be fully obedient. But I had to come to an understanding that that's what he was doing, that I wasn't going to have a road to Damascus conversion, right? But if I just kept seeking him and kept obeying him, that I would get better and I would get stronger and my faith would increase and my belief would increase. And that's what happened. It took a long time, like a long time. I don't even want, I was going to try to give it a number, but I'm not even going to do that. So Paul here, he's on his way. He's going to do some more damage. Why? He's angry. He hates Jesus. He hates God. He hates Christians, right? He's dedicated his life to harming them. And now he's on his way to continue the destruction. But here's the thing. He was so zealous. The Bible said he was so zealous for the law. He was so zealous in his persecution of Christians, right? God said, I've had enough. I've had enough of this guy, right? I'm going to stop him on this road to destruction, and I'm going to totally turn his life around 180 degrees. And now not only is he going to be zealous for me, he's going to be the opposite that he was in his persecution of Christians, and I'm going to use him to bring the gospel to the Gentiles, right? The Bible will tell you that the Apostle Peter was the first apostle to speak the gospel to the Gentiles, but Paul is credited with being the apostle to the Gentiles. No longer am I going to allow you to do this. In fact, I'm going to bring you into a new calling in your life, and you're going to bring the gospel to the Gentile nation. This is a miracle. This is a miracle we don't talk about. One of the miracles of Jesus is that he appeared to this man who was dead set against persecuting Christians, harming them, jailing them, locking them up, even killing them, witnessing the stoning of Stephen. Stephen is considered the first disciple that was ever killed for his faith, martyred for his faith. Paul sat there and watched it happen. In fact, even held the cloaks or the coats of the man who picked up stones to kill him. Do you believe that God can perform a miracle in someone's life if they're not a believer? Do you believe that God can perform a miracle if you don't believe in him? Well, God created you, right? So can God speak to you? This is a source of debate, right? On whether or not God hears the prayer of a sinner or God hears the prayer of an unbeliever, right? Well, don't you know that when you're calling out to God and you're saying, God, please help me, when you've exhausted everything else, every avenue in your life, right? And then we say, well, I have nothing else. I have nothing left. I'm going to cry out to God because I need a change in my life. I need to go in a different direction. And you're not a believer before you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. Does God hear you then? He absolutely does, because he created you and he hears everyone, right? So don't you know that when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior before you were a believer, that was a miracle? If it wasn't a miracle, then why does the Bible say that once you accept the Lord, all the angels in heaven rejoice and dance, right? Because that's a miracle. Every child of God that accepts the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, that is a miracle. This is a miracle when he appears to Paul. One of God's greatest miracles is getting your attention, right, and bringing you into the family of God. So when my father-in-law, who died at the ripe old age of 82, when he was dying in the hospital, right, we were all in there for weeks, every single day, praying for him, praying that God would keep him with us. But God had other plans, and he took him. But we were there every day praying for him, and there was a family in the next room. And we could hear them, and there was a lot of family members, and their son was in a car wreck. And he was in his early 20s, and he was dying, and he was on life support. And all the family was coming to visit him and to say their goodbyes to him. And when they had all come, and when they had all said goodbye, after a few days this went on, right, the mom of this boy came into our room, and she said, could you guys come and please pray for my son? She goes, we've tried everything else. We don't believe in your God, right? And we've tried everything else, but we're so desperate, right, that we're asking you guys, because we've heard you guys in here praying for weeks, could you come in and pray for our son, right? It didn't happen. The Lord saw fit to take that boy home too. But my point is, when you get to that desperate point and you're crying out to God, right, and you're not a believer, God still hears you, right? God still hears the prayers and the voices of the people that he created. He answers the prayer of every unbeliever. Every time an unbeliever asks Jesus to come into their hearts and forgive them, he answers them with yes. Are you a believer before you're saved? Did you know that Jesus prayed to the Father for you as a believer? Did you know that Jesus in John chapter 17, 6 through 19 prayed for you to the Father before he went to the cross? He prayed to God the Father for all believers that would walk this earth after he was gone. Did you know that he prayed to the Father for unbelievers, right? John chapter 17, verse 20 says, my prayer is not for them alone. What he's saying is, he's just got done praying to the Father for believers, and he says, my prayer is not for them alone, right? But for unbelievers. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. I pray for those who will believe in me through the message of the people that already do believe in me, right? Keep spreading the message. And here's the thing. Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, God says, he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. What does that tell you? That tells you that God created everyone. He didn't create anybody for hell. He gave you free choice to choose heaven, and he created everyone. He loves everyone. He hears the prayers of everyone. God loves everyone, even if you don't love him. Even if you hate him as Paul did, even if you've harmed his children as Paul did, he still loves you. Can you comprehend a love like that? No, we cannot. We cannot comprehend a love like that from God, and God tells us, don't even try. Don't even try to comprehend my love. Just keep doing what I've called you to do. But here's the thing. We receive it, right? We can't comprehend your love, God, but we receive it graciously, right? Because we're sinners in need of a Savior. So we receive your love. We don't understand how you could love somebody like Paul when he's out to kill your people, and then when you bring him into the kingdom, right, that we're supposed to accept that. That's a difficult thing for us. Let's just be real and honest. When we see somebody out there that's a murderer, a serial killer, somebody that's put their family to shame or to death, and then they have this jailhouse conversion, we don't like it. We can't comprehend that, right? So then we start to question God, like, how is this fair? How is it fair that we might see Adolf Hitler in heaven? How is it fair that a man can kill his wife and his children and then have a conversion in prison, and we're supposed to accept that, right? You know what I say? To be quite honest with you, I don't accept it. But I don't have the heart of God. I didn't create that person. And I'm not going to say and be phony and say, oh, yeah, that's awesome. I can't wait to see that guy in heaven. That's going to be great. I'm going to go have a coffee with Adolf Hitler, right? Because I can't, in my feeble, tiny brain, I can't understand that. And so I hear Christians all the time say, well, hallelujah, if Charles Darwin is in heaven and Adolf Hitler is in heaven and Jeffrey Dahmer is in heaven. Not for me. Not hallelujah for me. My thing is, you got some splaining to do, God, when I get there, right? Because when I get there, Lord, you're going to have to tell me, right, exactly how this guy made it in, right? But of course, the Bible says that in the twinkling of an eye, as soon as you open your eyes in heaven, you will be enlightened and you will be like God. You will be like Christ, right? And you will not have any questions because your questions will all be answered, right? And so you won't have to go to him and go, yeah, how'd that guy that killed 6 million Jews, how did he make it, right? You'll open your eyes and you go, thank God he's not here. Thank God he's in hell where he should have been, right? Let's face it, we can't comprehend that. We can't comprehend somebody that did that much damage, right, going to heaven. It's totally unfair to us, right? So it's just something that we're going to have to live with until we get there. And we'll get all the answers when we get there, right? And what the enemy wants to do is make you ponder that and try to comprehend that. And if you can't comprehend that, if you can't comprehend that bad people that did extremely bad stuff on this earth are going to go to heaven, then the enemy gets in your ear and says, God doesn't exist. God doesn't love you. God doesn't care. You don't understand. You're worshiping something that isn't real. A real God of love would never accept the repentance of Adolf Hitler or anyone of the like, right? But we can't understand that. And that's the thing that keeps us from being completely, totally obedient to the Lord, because we don't have the same kind of understanding. But know that the Lord said in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 and 9, don't try to figure me out. You don't know my ways. My ways are higher than your ways. My ways are not your ways. Don't try to figure me out. Just keep doing what I told you to do, right? Why do you think he said, I gave you warnings? I've given you warnings of the end times. I've given you signs to look for, right? So that you can be even more zealous in spreading the gospel. When the time is short, we need to be even more diligent about getting the word out, right? Why can't we have another revival? Why can't we have another revolution before the end times? Which means that we're going to go out and we're going to redo what they did in the 70s and other reformations, and we're going to bring the gospel to as many people as we can, because the signs of the times are there and the time is short. That doesn't mean we back off. That means you press in further, right? Amen. Because he said no one knows the day or the hour, right? So that means here's the warning signs. You're already, he didn't give you warning signs so you can get right. Well, it's part of it, right? But it's not so much so, well, I'm good, right? You're good. You're a believer. You're seeking God. You're going to heaven, right? The signs are for us as Christians to spread the gospel in a more fervent way. Are you with me, church? God said, I'm going to use you, Saul, to bring the gospel to the Gentiles. The guy that everyone hates. The guy that all of Christianity despises. The one that everyone is in fear of and afraid of. And we think of Paul as a self-appointed apostle. We think, how did he become an apostle? He wasn't even a believer while Jesus was on this earth. But Jesus appeared to Paul. And don't you know that Jesus appearing to Paul after the resurrection qualified Paul to be an apostle, right? Qualification to be an apostle was to be a witness to the resurrection of Jesus, right? And God didn't change Paul's name from Saul to Paul. We always think that somewhere in the Bible, God must have changed Paul's name from Saul to Paul. Jews living in the Roman Empire had two names. His Hebrew name was Saul, and his Roman name was Paul, right? And he deferred to his Roman name because he primarily ministered to the Roman world. He was a Roman citizen. He was a Jewish, Hebrew, Roman citizen, a Pharisee. And he primarily brought the word, the gospel, to the Roman Empire and to the Gentiles and Hellenistic Jews. So when he was doing that, he referred to his Roman name, which was Paul. And God didn't change his name along the way. So he has experience, and then the Lord, he says, Lord, right? And this is where we fall short sometimes, because he has this experience, right? The Lord appears to him, changes his life in the twinkling of an eye, and then it's not like the genie in the bottle, right? All right, three wishes. What can you do for me, God, right? Now that you have my attention, God, what can you do for me, right? I have decided, for your sake, Jesus, to become one of your disciples, to become one of your children, right? And so, since we've entered into this agreement, what's in it for me, right? What can I do? What can I get, right? But Paul says the complete opposite. So right away, he's on the right track. Right away, you know that he's been converted 180%, right? Because he says, Lord, in Luke 17:6, what do you want me to do? A fully surrendered heart asks God, what do you want me to do for you, Lord? The selfish heart asks God, what can you do for me, God, right? What is the quote from John Kennedy? Ask not what God can do for you, but what you can do for God. Amen? Paul says, Lord, what do you want me to do? He says, arise and go into the city and you will be told what you must do. So he goes. The men who journeyed with him, however, stood speechless, hearing a voice but seeing no one. Now you have to know that these men were a part of Paul's previous life. All of a sudden, he's had an encounter with God, and his life has changed in an instant, and now you know he has to be looking at these guys like, what about you? What's going to happen to these guys, right? The first thing you need to do, Saul, God says to him, is you need to get away from these dudes, right? I got to get you away from them, right? I've given you new life. And I need to get you away from your old life. That includes your old friends. I need to get you away from these people, and I need to get you around some godly people. Some godly people that believe in me, that are going to help you and be for you and minister to you. And until you walk away from your old friends, even if it's family, right, you still got one foot in the darkness, right? So you need to walk away from those people. And I know it sounds harsh just to turn 180 and walk away from people that you've known your whole life. But let me save you some aggravation. Just rip the Band-Aid off and do it, right? Because eventually, if you want to serve God, you can't serve man, right? Eventually, if you want to be completely, totally obedient to God, the Bible says, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers, right? So that's where we have to be careful. We're bringing the gospel to an unbelieving world, but we can't be in partnership with them, right? There is, the Bible says, don't shoot the messenger. The Bible says that there's no fellowship with darkness, right? Light does not mesh with darkness, and there's no fellowship for the light with darkness. And so you have to walk away from your old friends. And I had to do this, and it was a hard thing. I grew up with guys that I've known since I was 3-4 years old. And I had to walk away from them, and it was difficult. And I wanted to hang on to that. And all it did was cause me a bunch of problems. So if that's you or somebody you know, give them this advice. Just cut it off. If those people are going to be in your life, God will bring them back around, right? God will take care of them. Remember Jonah, right? Remember Jonah, they were like, what? You mean your disobedience to God has caused this ship to sink? What did they do? They picked him up and they chucked him off the boat, right? Like, dude, we're not going down for you. And then what? They all accepted the Lord, and then the Lord took care of Jonah. When he was fledging around in the water, then it was between Jonah and the whale, right? So sometimes you got to throw some people overboard, right? It's just the reality of it, because you have to cut that off. You have to cut that cancer off, right? And you can't hold on to it, or it's going to cost you, and it's going to separate you at some point from the Lord. So you can't walk and serve man and serve God at the same time, and that's what that means. So I need you, before I can get you to a path of complete obedience and righteousness, I need to get you away. I need to get you to a place around other believers where I can speak clearly to you. You have a timeout, right? He blinded him for 3 days. I'm going to give you a little timeout, Paul. Some R&R with some of my people, right? I need to get you away from everything and everyone that causes you to sin, or to be tempted, or to slip back into your past, or to question me and yourself, God is saying. Right? Because your friends, right, when you get converted, what do? They want you to question your conversion. They want you to question the decision you made, right? And they want to make fun of you for it. Oh.
Oh, yeah.
What's the one we've always heard? Oh, so you think you're holier than thou now, right? Oh, so you think you're better than me, right? Oh, so you think you are righteous. And my answer is always, yeah. But you can be too, right? You can be just as holy and forgiven as me if you want to. Right? I've told this story many times, but the power of the Word of God and continuing to pray for your family members. My brother-in-law, who's very dear to me, very close with him, and he was raised in a Christian home, same as my wife, and he fell away from the Lord for a long time, and he was bitter. All through his 20s and 30s, he was bitter. And so everybody in the family was walking with the Lord and seeking the Lord, and he'd fallen away. And so all he ever wanted to do was take shots at us. And we all prayed for him and prayed for him for years, 2 decades. And we kind of just, you know, throw up a prayer for him thinking like, well, He's been this way for so long, we didn't never thought that he would return to the Lord, right? And so what he used to say to me when I first got saved, right, because we worked together and we were pretty close. And so he would, rib me and say, "Hey, so how's that Jesus thing working for you?" And I'd be like, "Oh, man, I didn't even know how to answer it," right? I'm like, I wasn't a mature enough Christian to give him an answer. I'm thinking like, "What do you mean, how's it working for me? I don't know, you know?" And he goes, "You're just using it as a crutch, dude, right? You just traded one lifestyle for another, right? You're just using Jesus as a crutch, right?" And I would be like, I wouldn't even know how to respond. And I'd be thinking to myself, "Man, is he right? Am I just using Jesus to take the place of drugs and alcohol and this dark life and a sinful life?" And Jesus said to me one day, "You bet your butt you are." Right? And I finally got all proud and I went back to him and I said, "Yeah, because I got a broken leg," right? "And don't tell me that a crutch is a bad thing, because I'm a broken person with a broken leg and Jesus is my crutch, and that's a good thing." Amen? So the next time somebody tells you that you're leaning on Jesus and using him as a crutch, you can say, "You bet I am." Everybody should be leaning on Jesus and walking with him and allowing him to help you walk, right? He'd be upset with me if he heard this. He's a Christian now, though. He returned. The prodigal, yeah. He's a good boy. If you read Acts 17, 10 through 19, God told Ananias to go and get Paul and minister to him. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He received his sight back. And he was baptized, right? This is the difference in just a few moments or hours or days, right, where he is on his way to harm Christians, to even kill them, to bring them bound back to Jerusalem, to imprison them. He's days away, if not less than that, from getting into the presence of a Christian by the name of Ananias. Now all of a sudden, right, his sight is restored to him. He's been forgiven, and Ananias baptizes him. That is the difference between hanging out with your old friends, right, and not getting completely away from them, right? Because if you don't cut them off completely, then all this over here, which is baptism, blessing, your sight restored, your health restored, your financial status restored, your job restored, your family restored, your marriage restored, your relationship with your children restored, is in jeopardy if you can't walk away from this over here, right? So you got to ask yourself, what's more important? My life and the life that God has ordained for me, and the love and the success and the joy and the peace, or these dudes, right? And you might think it's such an easy thing, because once you can, if you can't see this side, right, then it's not so easy to walk away from this side. Because these are your bros, man. These are my guys. These are my buddies. Every Thursday night, man, we're out. It's guys' night out. Dude, it's girls' night out. Stay home. If you're married, go home. Right? Guys' night out. That's not for us. We're married. We're married people. We have a wife at home. Go home and take care of your family, right? You don't need to be out there causing trouble, putting yourself at risk, getting in the car after you've had too much to drink, right? Go home to your wife. That's why you got married. Amen, all you ladies. So when he had received food, Acts 17, 19, after he had received food, he was strengthened. Then Saul, Paul, spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. He got around some godly people. He got around good people. People that were going to love on him, pray for him, take care of him, feed him, right? When you feel lost and you feel tired and you feel hungry and you're blinded, surround yourself with God's people who are for you. This is why we're in this together. This is why Jesus assembled 12 guys to himself. You know, he could have done it by himself. He didn't need 12 disciples. He did it for them, not for himself. He did it so he could teach them, you guys need each other. You guys are going to go out there onto the battlefield. Every single one of you except one is going to be killed in my name, right? You're going to need to lean on each other to go out there and do it. And believe it or not, 2,000 plus years later, we are those people. We are those disciples. We need to lean on each other, right? And when we're feeling hungry and tired and broken, right? And we're in pain and we need prayer, we don't go to our old friends. We don't go to the unbelieving world. We go to the people that we know are going to pray for us. We go to the people that we know God is listening to, right? What's the first thing you think about when you're in a difficult situation, right? Well, I need to call the pastor, right? Or I need to call so-and-so because he's godly. He walks with the Lord. And I need him to pray. And that's what you need to do when you're in those situations. We need to stick together and walk away from the old and into the new. And this is the thing. This is why your life changes. And if your life doesn't change, maybe you're not fully saved yet. Maybe you're not fully obedient to God yet because you haven't totally surrendered to him. Because you can't walk with part of the old and part of the new on you. For 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That means your old life has it's dead. It no longer is in existence. It no longer is available to you. Or, right? You don't become completely new. You don't become completely new in a new creation until you put off the old. You can't do it. You don't buy a new car, right, with old tires and an old motor on it and go, hey, man, this thing's pretty cool, right? You don't do that. Be like, I want all new stuff. So God completely wiped the slate clean for Paul. Regardless of what Paul has done, God wiped away his sin, his sorrow, his remorse, and his guilt. Even though Paul still carried guilt with him to the end of his life, in his heart he knew that he had been fully forgiven and that God had removed his guilt. He was now a new creation. Everything he did in his past means nothing to God. Everything that he did in his past means nothing to him now that he knows Jesus. Everything he was in his past life means nothing now that he is a child of God. He was an educated man. He spoke 5 languages. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees, a respected person in his community, a pillar in his community. Yet after his conversion, he said this in 1 Corinthians 4:10, I am just a fool for Jesus, right? I love that. I'm just a fool for Jesus. There's an old song, I'm just a fool for your love or something like that, right? Fog hat, come on. Nobody remembers that, do you? Fool for the city. Yeah, that was good. Good, Pastor Timothy correcting me. In 1 Corinthians 2:2, he said, I profess to know nothing now. 5 languages, a Pharisee of Pharisees, right? A successful man. Now he says, I profess to know nothing but Christ and him crucified. Now that I've been created a new person, a new creation, I profess to know nothing without Christ. I can do nothing without Christ. I can do all things with Christ, right? I profess to know nothing. Why? Because I have started over my life completely. I have surrendered my life to God, and I have started completely over, and I have let the shackles and the chains of sin and damnation fall off of me. But you know, he still had some guilt. Because he said this in 1 Corinthians 15, 9 and 10. He says, "For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle." So if you think he appointed himself an apostle, he didn't. Right? I have to believe that the other living apostles at this time appointed him or titled him an apostle. He said himself, "I'm not worthy to be an apostle because," right? "Because I persecuted the church and the children of God. But by the grace of God, I am who I am." Hallelujah, church. By the grace of God, I am who I am. And who is that? You are forgiven. You are a forgiven child of God, no matter what you did. No matter if you persecuted God, you persecuted his people, you persecuted the church. If you repent and you ask for forgiveness, you become a forgiven child of God. God forgives all of us, all our sins, without exception. If God has forgiven us, then why? Why can't we forgive ourselves? Because the enemy wants to always remind you of your past. Because the memories of what we've done still haunt us. Because the enemy uses the memories of what we've done in the past to still haunt you. Paul hated Jesus, and he was determined to persecute anyone who followed him. Those memories stayed with him his entire life. Although he knew God had fully forgiven him, he said, "I am the least of these." Yet he knew he was a forgiven child of God. He still said, "I am not worthy to be an apostle." You need to remind yourself daily of who you are, and that is a forgiven child of God. When the devil reminds you of your past, remind him of his future. Jesus remembers your sins no more. The feeling of guilt that comes from God is called conviction, right? The feeling of guilt that comes from Satan is called condemnation. The enemy wants you to condemn yourself over your guilt, right? The Holy Spirit wants you to correct yourself with that guilt, right? When you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you and you step out of God's will for your life, and you know when you do that, right, then the Holy Spirit says, "No, no, 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 no. You start to feel guilty, right, because you're slipping away from God." And the Holy Spirit says, "Use that guilt to get back on track. Use that guilt to correct yourself because you don't want to get too far." Know this, you don't want to get too far. Don't think that you can play with fire. Don't think that you can play with sin. Don't think that you have time to get back into the good graces of God, right? Because you never know when he's going to take you away. And guess what? If you ain't walking with the Lord in 100% obedience, when that day comes, you're going to get left behind, right? That's why we stay close to him. Because we know, we're human beings, if we knew the day or the hour, we would live it up until the day before. We would. Well, like he's coming back on January 17, 2024. Man, we are going to party this Christmas, man. I'm going to spend all my money. I'm going to sell my house and go to Tahiti. It's going to be great. And then in January, we're going to go to heaven. It's going to be awesome. Don't you think he knows that? Don't you think that's why he said, "You don't know the day or the hour, because I know you better than you know yourself." In Acts 9, 10 through 19, God commands a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias to go and find Paul and lay hands on him. Ananias freaks out. And he says this in Acts 9, 13, 14. He says, "Lord." Lord says, "Ananias, go get Paul." Can you imagine? What? I have heard from many, this is Ananias saying, God, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name. Right? And God says, oh, now that you put it that way. Right? No, he says, go anyway. I don't care. I have chosen Paul as a vessel to bring the gospel to the Gentiles. I will protect you. When God says go, go, right? If you want the full blessing of God, when he tells you to go somewhere, go. Because he's going to use somebody else if you don't, and they're going to get the blessing, and you're not, because you didn't answer the call, and you weren't completely obedient to the Lord. And I know, as human beings on this planet, right, we want everything that God has for us. We want all the blessings, right? Because you don't want to get to the pearly gates and see a table full of blessings that you missed out on. When you get there, right, you want to say, I lived the best possible life that I could live, and nothing was left on the table. I got to heaven, and everything that God had for me on earth, he gave it to me because I was completely, totally obedient to him. The last thing you want to do is get there and go, ah, I missed all that, right? Oh, thank God, I barely made it in, but I could have had all that. And you don't, yeah, we're not going to have any regrets in heaven. This is a moot point. I'm just trying to make a point, right? I'm just trying to get you to walk in obedience. So Ananias goes down there and he lays hands on a man who is coming to harm him. He lays hands and he goes down there and he prays over Paul. His sight is restored. And he prays over Paul, a man who was coming to most likely kill him and his family and other people in the community. So how do you pray for a man who is coming to kill you? How do you pray for someone who has harmed you or your loved ones? Matthew chapter 5, verse 44 says, but I say to you, you know this one, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Do you want everything that God has for you? Are you in complete 100% obedience to God, and do you want all the blessings and the best life you could possibly live on this earth, then you better start praying for your enemies. Because that's part of it. That's a commandment from God. And I know it's hard. I know it's difficult, right? And you don't have to spend hours in your prayer closet praying for your enemy, right? Just lift them up a quick prayer. Yeah, God, change their heart. Yeah, God, forgive them. Yeah, God, keep them away from me, right? You don't have to, and you don't have to be, you don't have to hang out with them, and you don't have to be around them, and you have to be friends from them, but you absolutely have to pray for them, right? Because if you don't, you're missing out on one of the commandments that God has given you. Love your neighbor as yourself, right? I don't like my neighbor. Too bad. God said, love your neighbor as yourself, right? Well, I don't want to pray for my enemies. Well, the Bible says pray for your enemies and pray without ceasing. So keep praying for your enemies until the day you die if you want all the blessings from God. I'm fired up today, church. Are you? Ice cream fires me up. I got fired up. And we got to end this because we got to get out there. So here's the thing. Can you do it? Can you do it? Can you lay hands on the person who hurt you? Can you go to that person and lay hands on them and pray for them? Can you pray for their healing? Can you pray for their salvation, right? Can you pray for God to reveal himself to them? Can you do that to a person that really wanted to harm you? Did you know that sometimes by praying for your enemies, you can turn them into your friends? Did you know that? This has happened to me so many times in my life where I prayed for people that were against me and Lisa, right? Even in our own family, like I said. And if you continue to pray for them and God works on them, because when you're praying for those people, then God is working on them, right? God is speaking to them. God's hearing your prayers and he's saying, okay, I'm going to get their attention. I'm going to stop them on the road to Damascus. I'm going to speak to them. I'm going to show myself to them, right? I'm going to allow them to become blind for 3 days so that I can get their attention, right? Right? Sometimes God uses tragedy to get your attention, right? God will use whatever he needs to do to get your attention, right? Because he knows. He knows you need him. He knows you're crying out to him. Even if you're not being public with it, he knows it. Well, I don't feel like it. I don't feel like praying for them. I don't like them. They don't like me. How many times? They don't like me, so I don't like them. Right? Tough cookies, man. You got to pray for them. Did you know that if you don't pray for your enemies, you're separating yourself from God? Because it's a commandment. God has commanded you to do it, right? So if you don't, what you're doing is you're taking a little step away, right? Every time you say, I don't want to do it, you take a little step away. And then another step, I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. I don't want to be completely obedient. And the next thing you know, you're looking at your old friends. And you're starting to look back on your old life and you're thinking, it wasn't that bad, right? It wasn't that bad. Waking up, the hangover, right? Waking up with no money in your pocket, right? Waking up with an empty bag of dope, right? No money. That's a great life. You wouldn't want to walk away from that, would you? It's a commandment. If you want the full blessings of God, pray for your enemies. If you want your breakthrough and your miracle, pray for your enemies. If you want a better life and a better life on earth and a better relationship with God, pray for your enemies. You better start praying.